not mine.
Thank you, Nicole. And I would like to thank the organizers, and especially Shiri, for the invitation. And I will talk about this pretty recent work with Shai Giron.
Can you raise your voice, please?
I will try. Better? Okay, so let omega n be the set of all subsets of a set of n elements. And let Pn be the family of probability distribution on omega n. Occasionally, it will be convenient to think of Pn as very naively as the set of functions from omega n to the non-negative real numbers, such that the sum of Pa over all A in omega n is 1. The main object of the talk is the following quantity. Suppose we draw independently R plus 1 sets from omega n according to a probability distribution P. What is the probability that the first set is contained in the union of the others? We call this quantity, we denote it by tau r of p. And we will be interested in the minimum of this quantity over all distribution in Pn. In a minute, we'll get to a more concrete question. But I would like to mention that originally we got interested in this because it has some motivation coming from cryptology. I will not explain the relationship.
It's not that the set is from the n of omega, what is it?
What is? S naught and all the other S's are random sets drawn independently according to the same probability distribution P. Now, this minimum cannot be zero because actually it must be at least 1 over 2 to the n, because S0 is contained in the union of the others, at least when S0 is equal to one of the others. And one may suspect, and this was our suspicion, that in order to minimize tau r of p, this should be the only contribution to tau r of p. In other words,
a quick clarification, maybe. Yes. It may be important to know when you choose these random sets, you exclude. It's possible that the same set may be
yes.
chosen more than once.
Yes. Otherwise, it is trivial. Otherwise, the minimum is zero. Exactly because we can use a distribution that is supported on an R cover free family. An R cover free family is a family of sets, such that no set in the family is contained in the union of R other sets in F. It's written R or less just to handle the case that the family is very small. But you should think of R. So what I said earlier translate to that to the speculation that the minimum of tau r is obtained on distributions that are supported on such families. We will use the following additional notation. Let gr of n be the maximal cardinality of an R cover free family in omega n. For example, when R is 1, a 1 cover free family is just an anti chain. No set is contained in another, anti chain with respect to inclusion, set inclusion. And so Sperner's classical theorem tells us that G1 of n is n over is n choose n over 2, the middle binomial coefficient. For larger values of R, this quantity was also studied, but there are no exact results. There are some bounds. Erdős, Frankel, and Furedi showed these bounds for G2, and later these bounds for general R. And another bound, upper bound, the following upper bound was obtained by Diashkov and Rykov. And in this form, with the explicit constant 8 there, it's due to Lusinko, who also gave a simpler proof. So now we can formulate the question. So let us denote by CF n of R distribution in Pn that are supported on R cover free families. And the question is the minimum of tau R over all the probability distribution is obtained on some distribution that is supported on an R cover free family. And the answer is yes for R equals 1. For R equals 1, the minimum of tau 1 of P over all distribution, probability distribution is obtained on the one cover free families, a probability distribution supported on one cover free families, that's anti-chains, and it's exactly 1 over the middle binomial coefficient. We can also describe exactly on what distribution attained this minimum. So, pretty easy to guess, but I will not get into that here. On the other hand, for R larger than 1, the answer is strictly negative. The minimum over all probability distribution is smaller than the minimum over those probabilities distribution supported on R cover free families by an exponential factor. The proofs are very simple, so I have time to show almost complete proofs, and still we will get early to lunch. So let's start with theorem 1. So one thing is very clear, that if we take a uniform distribution on a maximal anti-chain, let the tilde be such a distribution uniformly supported on a anti-chain of maximal cardinality, then tau 1 is exactly 1 over the middle binomial coefficient, and we want to show that this is the minimum. That is, that for every probability distribution, tau 1 of p is at least 1 over the middle binomial coefficient. And here it will be convenient to just use the explicit formula for tau 1 over t in terms of the values that the probability distribution gives to the distinct elements of omega n. So this is sum, the sum of all pairs such that a0 contained in a1, the probability of a0 times the probability of a1. Let C be the set of all maximal chains in omega n with respect to inclusion. Every set belongs to exactly the number of maximal chains divided by n choose cardinality of a maximal chains. This is very, very, very simple because every maximal chains contain exactly one set of each cardinality, and there's a complete symmetry. If we have two sets with the same cardinality, then each of them clearly belong to the same number of maximal chains. So if we use this, then we get this equality. On the right-hand side, there is an external sum over all the maximal chains, and then for every such maximal chain, we sum something over the sets in this chain. And since we've put here this term, and we know that each set belongs to exactly this number of maximal chains, then this is exactly like summing over the omega n, whatever is written here. We will actually use this another time for a different function of a. Since the binomial coefficients are all smaller or equal to the middle binomial coefficients, we get the following inequality. So on the left-hand side, we just use that the middle binomial coefficient is the largest, and on the right-hand side, we just rearrange a little. Similarly, we can look at pairs of sets such that one pair is strictly contained in the other, and then similar reasoning to what I said earlier shows that every such pair appears in exactly this many maximal chains, and again we can use it to get a similar inequality. So the first inequality is because here the numerator is less than the middle binomial coefficient, and the denominator is always at least 2. And then we again use the fact that we know that each such pair appears in exactly this many maximal chains. And the last equation is just a rearrangement, and these two disappeared, but instead of summing over all pairs such that a0 is strictly contained in a1, here we sum over all pairs such that a0 and a1 are different, and because they belong to the same to a maximal chain, or to a chain, then one of them is contained in the other. So this is exactly the missing two. Well, we've just shown this inequality, and a little bit earlier we've shown this inequality, and we can sum them up. On the right hand side, we get an average of all maximal chains of these squares. Now, notice that the sum that we have on the left hand side is exactly tau 1 of p. We want to show that this is at least 1 over the middle binomial coefficient. So So we need to show that the left-hand side is at least one. So it's enough to show that the right-hand side is at least one. And this is very, very easy. Again, by Jensen inequality, the average of the squares is at least the square of the average. And then we can rearrange it just as before and use the fact that each set A belong to this many maximal chains to get that this is exactly the sum of all PA, so it is one. This concludes the proof of theorem one. Now, for the proof of theorem two, we first show the following very plausible claim. For every probability distribution supported on a cover-free family, there should be an R there, R cover-free family. Tau of R is at least one over the size, the cardinality of the largest, the maximum cardinality of an R cover-free family. So let's see why this is true. So this probability distribution is supported on some R cover-free family. Let's call it F. Since the distribution is supported on an R cover-free family, here we get that the only way that the probability that S0 is contained in the union of the others is exactly the probability that S0 is equal to one of the others. So we get this explicit expression. We sum over all sets in F, the probability that S0 is this set times the probability that at least one of the other sets is this set. And this is at least the sum of the squares of PF.
You don't care about the factor of R here. I mean, you can get
yes. Yes. Eventually, it will be an exponential gap. And again, by Jensen inequality, we get that tau of P is at least one over the size of F, which is at least one over the size, the maximal size of an R cover-free family. Now, using this claim, it's very easy. It's easy in all the cases, but it's very easy in the to get the conclusion, the desired conclusion, when R is large. So first, by the claim and the bound of the Zinkho, we get that the minimum over the of tau R over the distribution supported on cover-free families is at least 1 over GR of N, which is, by the bound of Kuzinko, at least 1 over R to the 8 N over R squared. So we need to find some probability distribution that for which tau of R is much smaller. It's not an exotic distribution. We just take a uniform distribution of all sets of fixed size, and it turned out that the best size to take is N over ER, the best for this computation. We don't know that this is this achieves the minimum, but it's enough to show that the minimum is strictly smaller than over the R cover of the distribution supported on R cover-free families. So let PL be this distribution, uniformly supported on the family of all L element sets in omega n for this L. Now we estimate tau R of P in the most naive way. If we already chose S1 to SR, then the union is the cardinality of the union is at most L times R. So the probability that the first set S0 is contained in this union is surely bounded by RL choose L over N choose L. And then very standard estimates gets us to what's written on the end. So we see here the what we want to beat. And here there's some number to an exponent of some number. And it turns out that for every R that is at least 101, this is indeed smaller than 1. So for large R, it is very easy. What do we do for general R? The method for general R works also for large R. I just wanted to show that it's very simple for large R. And it's fairly simple for general R. But now we don't use the bound of Rusinko, which is better for large R. We need the bound the other bound of Erdős, Frankel, and Furedi, which is better for a smaller R. But it works as it works also for large R. So by the claim and the bound of Erdős, Frankel, and Furedi, after some manipulation, we get the minimum of tau r over distributions supported on cover-free families is at least n over l, RL choose l over n choose l plus 1, where l is an integer in the interval between 0 and n over r for which this quotient is the maximum. It can be sorted out exactly what this L is, but we don't need it. And then we're again taking a distribution which is not at all exotic. It's just, again, the uniformly supported on the family of all element sets in omega n, but this time for this value of n. And all we need to do is to estimate tau r of pl a little bit more carefully. So let us denote by A the event that we want to compute its probability. And let us also denote by E the event that the union of the other sets, not S0, is large. It's larger than RL minus T for an appropriate T, which we will choose in later. And now we can just break up the probability of A, which is what we want to compute, in the following manner. The probability of A conditioned on omega n on the complement of E, we can naively bound from above as before. And on E. And on the conditional probability of A on E, we can bound as before. And on the complement of E, we can bound it in the same manner, but get a better bound. So we get RL choose L over N of N choose L for the condition probability of A conditioned on E, and the better bound RL minus T choose L over N choose L for the probability of A conditioned on the complement of E. And after some rearrangement, we get at the end what we want, what we want to beat. And here, something that we should show that is exponentially small, and it is some computation, but that I will not show. But it's very easy to believe that the second term is exponentially small when t is not too is small, and the probability of E is exponentially small when T is not too large. So we can easily choose some T for which this will work. And that's all. Happy birthday, Vitaly. It's exponentially full. We know it from both sides. So,
do you expect it at a certain distribution?
I have no concrete guess. It's an interesting question, but maybe it's somewhat delicate because so we already know that it's exponentially small. So we have the trivial lower bound of 1 over 2 to the n. Because the same argument...
1 over 2 to the n is the same
set. Yes. Here it's equality because... P is supported on an R cover free family, but it's always true that this is at least this when you sum over the support of the distribution, which may be all omega n. So this way we get 1/2 to the n as a lower bound. As you suggested, we can R over 2. Okay, so we didn't try. Should. So some other post-set. No, it could be a nice generalization.